Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. We're talking about how we integrate the C++ layer with a QML level. There is one thing that is worse than getting your teeth pulled out, and that is pointers that you leak. So we want to avoid that at any cost. And how? Which pointers do we talk about in this setup here? We talk about the QObject pointers that are either owned on the C++ side using, the parent-child relationship, or you explicit calling delete on them, or they are owned on the QML side where we have the garbage collector. So who owns those? We do not want them to be deleted twice, but on the other hand, we do not want them to be deleted zero times either. There's this one in the between that is the magic soft spot. The rule is as follows. Objects or elements that has been created on the C++ side are owned by the C++ side. So far, we've only seen how we can create objects on the C++ side. So your own object, we haven't seen that yet, how you can create those on the QML side. We'll see that in the next two videos. Elements that's been created on the QML side, on the other hand, are owned by QML. You can specify that using set object ownership, where you specify which side do they belong to. Now there's one exception, and that's the whole reason why we have this particular video here. Had it just been the general rule, everything would have been fine, but there's one exception, namely that if you export a Q object that is parentless from a Q invocable method, then it will actually be owned by the QML side. And I have an example that shows you how terrible things can go, so let's just jump right into it. Let's just run the example right away. So the example, let's go to the QML file to start with and see what we do here. I got a column, and the column has a repeater to fill it. The repeater fills mouse area.press. So if the mouse is being pressed down, then the model is zero elements. Otherwise, it's underscore user list.count. And underscore user list is an object that I exported from the C++ side. The elements that we see in that list over here are simple rectangles that has a text inside it, and the text is looking like this: text colon underscore user list dot user at model dot index dot name. So on my C++ side, I have a poor man's version of a model. It can tell you how many elements there is. That is what my user list.count tells me, and you can go and ask for each of those elements using this user list.user at an index. Now, I press down my mouse button, and that means that the mouse area.press is now true, meaning that I'll have zero element. But when I release the mouse button, my application goes away. I can look at my application output. It says the process was ended forcefully, and the program has unexpectedly finished. Well, it's a matter of who's looking at it. I expected it to finish. I used that joke already, didn't I? Oh man, I'm bad. Let's go and look at the C++ side of how we are exporting our objects and what we're doing with them. So on the C++ side, I have this underscore user list that I export, and my user list looks like this. It has this property that is called count. That's the one I use there. And it has this Q underscore invocable that returns a Q object pointer. Obviously, because that's what we are trying to get in trouble with, the Q object pointer user at, and then a given element. It has a vector of user pointers. That is the elements that I export to the QML side. So my constructor, simply setting up my four users here. A user is a very simple subclass of QObject. It has this property called name. That's what I read on the QML side. And well, that's basically it. Observe that my user do not specify a parent here. And as my user's constructor doesn't do anything special with parent either here, I simply have a QObject without any parents. And that's a key thing about this example here. So I have my user, it's a QObject that it doesn't have a parent. I return it in this method called userAt. So I return the element here, I return m underscore user at index. And remember the rules. Elements created on the C++ side will have C++ ownership. Elements created on the QML side will have QML ownership, unless that they are returned, unless it's a QObject subclass that is returned from C++ via a Q invocable, which is exactly what we do. In that case, it will have JavaScript ownership. So when I press down the mouse button, my model will now be zero, which means that all my elements in that model will go away. The JavaScript interpreter will say, ooh, they are out, they are not used anymore. And then it will call the garbage collector to go and kill them. And then when I release, I again say that my list is four elements long, because my list didn't change. It was just the four users that now have been deleted in the list and therefore are dangling pointers, which has this tendency of making your application crash. And we can see here that whenever on my QML side, whenever I press down my mouse button, not only, where is it? Rectangle text, mouse area. Not only does this mouse area.pressed get updated to be zero, or mouse area.pressed red and my model being updated to be zero, I also call the garbage collector. So garbage collector, please unpress, do garbage collector right away so that we can get those elements deleted and force that crash through. The cure is even commented out here. Simply set that the objects should have C++ ownership. And now when they have C++ ownership, they will no longer be deleted by the QML side. Of course, QML will notice they go out of scope, but yes, they are owned by the C++ side. Of course, that's one cure. The other cure would be to simply give them a parent on the C++ side, because as it stands now, they do not have a parent. So I still need to be careful that it is me that needs to develop, to delete them whenever they go out of scope. I can feel that you don't trust me. So let me just run the application again. You can see press, they are away, they're here, they are away, they are here, they are away, they are here. Thank you for not trusting me, but you see, it does actually work. That was just a small intermediate. The next video we're going to talk about, we're going to talk about how do we create new elements that we can instantiate on the QML side. And those are especially those elements that will have QML ownership. So stay tuned. And until then, oh, did I mention, please do subscribe to our channel and have a great day. We'll be right back.